friends, welcome to the world of Companies Act 2013. I, Professor Kunal Shah, on behalf of JK Shah Classes, is welcoming you all towards the revisionary part of Companies Act 2013. Yes, my dear friends, in our previous video, we had successfully revised our chapter number 7 that was about management and administration of a company, wherein we have revised the provisions towards section number 88, section number 89, section number 90, and yes, we also revised various provisions towards general meetings. That is annual general meeting, extraordinary general meeting, notice of a general meeting, quorum, proxy, etc. So now in this video, we are going to begin our journey for a topic called as chapter number 8, that is declaration and payment of dividend. This entire chapter is given under chapter number 8 of Companies Act 2013, wherein under chapter number 8, section number 123 up to section number 127, the provisions are given right up to section number 123 up to section number 127 of Companies Act 2013. Before revising the provisions of this chapter, let us have the introductory part towards the word called as dividend. Yes, my dear friends, the word dividend simply means distribution of profits. However, it is section number 2, clause 35. Which defines the word called as dividend. The definition of the word dividend is of inclusive in nature. The lawmaker over here says that dividend includes interim dividend. Which means, what all are the provisions for a dividend, all those provisions will also be applicable in case of an interim dividend. What is interim dividend? I shall make you guys revise about the provisions of interim dividend as well. Before that, the word dividend can be classified, number one, on the basis of time. On the basis of time, we have got two types of dividend. One is the final dividend and another is the interim dividend. When I say final dividend, it is a dividend which has been recommended by the board of directors. It is declared by the members at the annual general meeting. So a dividend which has been recommended by the board and declared by the members at the annual general meeting, then such dividend is called as a final dividend. In fact, when I talk about interim dividend, it is a dividend which has been recommended by the board and it has been declared by the board of directors. Over here, whenever a company is working and the company has got some quarterly profits, and in between the year, if the company wants to declare a dividend, then such dividend is called as an interim dividend. See, for example, this is a financial year. For example, this is the financial year. Starting from 1st of April and ending on 31st of March. In this financial year, in between this financial year, if the company has a desire to distribute profits to its member, then such distribution of profit will be considered to be an interim dividend. However, if the financial year has been over, but the company is yet to call annual general meeting. And in between that period, if the company distributes a dividend, then even that dividend is to be considered as an interim dividend. So interim dividend is a dividend which will be declared between the financial year or else after completion of financial year, but before calling of an annual general meeting. However, any dividend declared at the annual general meeting will be considered as a final dividend. Over here, the word dividend can also be classified on the basis of shares. The word dividend can be classified as a preference dividend, that is a dividend which has been given to the preference shareholder, or else it can be classified as an equity dividend, that is a dividend which has been given to equity shareholders. Yes, my dear friends, shares are of two kinds. One is a preference share, another is an equity share. When I talk about preference share, that preference share can further be classified as cumulative preference share, or it can also be a non-cumulative preference share. It can be a cumulative preference share, or it can also be a non-cumulative preference share. Over here, when I talk about cumulative preference shares, so it is a share wherein the amount of dividend gets accumulated. For example, in one particular year, the company did not declare a preference dividend, but in the next year, the company is going to declare preference dividend. Then in that case, the company should pay for the previous year as well as for this year, which means the amount of dividend got accumulated till the time it was not being paid. But when I say non-cumulative preference share, then in that case, the amount of dividend does not get accumulated. If in one particular year, the company did not declare a preference dividend, then for the next year, you cannot demand a dividend for the previous year as well as for this year. So dividend can be classified on the basis of shares, wherein it can be a preference share or it can be an equity share. See, the dividend which has been given to a preference shareholder will be carrying a fixed rate of dividend, whereas the dividend given to an equity shareholder, it is always and always upon a fluctuating rate. The rate of dividend is not fixed in case of an equity share. So yes, my dear friends, we have successfully revised the introductory part of this chapter. And now we are going to start with the very first provision of this chapter. That is section number 123. One of the lengthiest provision, one of the important provision under chapter number 8 of Companies Act 2013. Section number 123 of Companies Act 2013 deals with declaration and payment of dividend. There are few provisions given inside section number 123, and all of those provisions we are going to revise one after one. All those provisions we are going to revise one after one. So let us revise the very first point under section number 123, which says about the sources of dividend. That is, from where the company can declare, from where the company can declare dividends. So the sources for declaration of dividend is, number one, the company can declare dividends either from the profits of current year, either from the profits of current year, or else the company can utilize the profits of previous years. That is, we are talking about the undistributed profits of previous years. Or else the company can utilize both the amounts, or else the company can utilize the amount provided by central government or state government. So whenever a company wants to declare dividend, whenever the company wants to declare dividend, the company can declare dividends either from the profits of current year, or else from the profits of previous years, or from both, or from the amount provided by central government or state government. See, whenever the company is going to declare dividends out of the profits, then yes, provisions for depreciation has to be always and always made. Provisions for depreciation has to be always and always made. So the very first point we have revised under section number 123 was about the sources of declaration of dividend. The second point we are going to revise under section number 123 is that, okay, sir, for suppose in the current year, the company has got a profit. In the current year, the company has got the profits. Okay. So, sir, is it mandatory for the company to transfer? Is it mandatory for the company to transfer certain part of its profits to reserves? The lawmaker over here says that such transfers is not mandatory, it is completely optional. Such transfer is not mandatory, it is completely optional. In fact, what percentage of profits, what percentage of profits will be transferred to reserves will be decided by the company. So what is the percentage of profits which is required to be transferred to reserves, even that will be decided by the company itself. So first of all, if in the current year the company has got a profit, then yes, it is not mandatory for the company to transfer certain amount of its profits to reserves. If the company wants to transfer it, then it will transfer. If the company does not want to transfer, they won't transfer. In fact, if the company is having a desire to transfer some part of its profits to reserves, then what percentage of profit should be transferred to reserves, even that decision will be taken by the company itself. The third point which we need to revise over here says that, okay, sir, if in the current year, for example, the company have got no profits. If in the current year, for example, if the company has got no profits, but still, if the company wants to declare a dividend, but still if the company wants to declare dividend, then still the company can declare a dividend. The lawmaker says yes, it is allowed. but the dividend will be declared. The dividend will be declared out of, the dividend will be declared out of reserves. The company can utilize its reserves. Sir, which reserves we can utilize over here? The lawmaker over here says the company can utilize the reserves called as free reserves. Other than free reserves, it cannot withdraw the money and distribute it as a dividend. So if in the current year the company has got no profits, but if still the company is having a desire to declare a dividend, then yes, the company can declare a dividend out of reserves. And to be more precise, the reserves over here has to be free reserves. The reserves over here has to be the free reserves. Okay. The fourth point says, when will the company declare dividend? When will the company declare dividend out of free reserves? So this will happen when either in the current year company has got loss, or else in the current year company has got insufficient profits. If any one of the given two situation arises, and still the company is having the desire to distribute dividends, then in that case, the company can withdraw the money out of free reserves. The company can withdraw money out of free reserves and distribute that money in a form of dividend. However, whenever a company is going to declare a dividend out of free reserves, then yes, the company is bound to follow certain rules. What are the rules? We are going to understand them in our point number 5. But all such rules are being exempted. All these rules are being exempted for a government company. See, for example, if in current year the company has got adequate profits, then sky is the limit. The company can declare dividends at any rate they want to declare. But if at all the company is going to declare dividends out of its free reserves, so such situation arises only when the company has got a loss in the current year, or else the company has got insufficient profits in the current year. If any one of the given situation arises, then only the company is going to withdraw some money from its free reserves if the company wants to. And if the company is going to withdraw money from its free reserves and declare a dividend out of its free reserves, then there are certain rules which the company needs to follow. However, all those rules are being exempted towards a government company. What are the rules which are required? What are the rules which are required to be followed by a company in order to declare dividends out of free reserves? What are the rules? So let us revise the rules one by one. The very first rule over here says that the rate of dividend the rate of dividend should be lesser than or equal to the average rate of dividends of last 3 years. The rate of dividend should be lesser than equal to the average rate of dividends of last 3 years. See, if you are going to distribute dividends only and only from your current year's profits, then sky is the limit. You can distribute any rate, any amount as a dividend. But if you are going to utilize some money from your free reserves and then you are going to declare dividends, then in that case, you need to follow rule number one, which says that the rate of dividend should be lesser than equal to, it should be either lesser than or equal to the average rate of dividend of last 3 years. For example, in last 3 years, the average rate of dividend comes out to be 100%. Then in this year, if the company is going to declare dividends out of free reserves, then yes, the rate of dividend should not be exceeding 100%. It can be lesser than 100%, but it can never be more than 100%. But if, for example, in last 3 years, the company had never declared dividend, then this rule, that is rule number one, is not required to be followed. The second rule the lawmaker says, what is the maximum amount the company can withdraw out of its free reserves? The maximum amount the company can withdraw out of its free reserves, it is 10% of paid up capital plus free reserves. It is maximum 10% of paid up capital plus free reserves. Company cannot withdraw a money greater than 10% of paid up capital plus free reserves. So if, for example, the paid up capital of the company is 100 crores and the free reserves is 900 crores, if you add both of them, then it comes out to be 1000 crores. And now if the company wants to withdraw some money from free reserves, then what is the maximum amount the company can withdraw from its free reserves? It is 10% of 1000 crore, that is 100 crores. The third rule the lawmaker over here says that whatever is the amount withdrawn shall be first utilized. Whatever is the amount withdrawn shall be first utilized to set off the losses. Should be first utilized to set off the losses. So, for example, if we have withdrawn 100 crores from our free reserves just to distribute dividend, that entire 100 crores cannot be utilized to distribute as a dividend. That 100 crores will be first utilized to set off the losses, if any. If there are no losses, then it's okay. You can distribute that entire 100 crores. The last rule over here, the lawmaker says that the balance inside the free reserves, should not fall below 15% of the paid up capital. So, for example, we have withdrawn 100 crores from our free reserves. After withdrawing that money, the money left out inside the free reserves should not be below 15% of the paid up capital. So if, for example, the paid up capital is 100 crores and if I take 15%, then it comes out to be 15 crores. So once I withdraw the money from my free reserves, then inside that free reserves, the balance should not be below that 15 crores. The balance should not be that below 15 crores. Okay. Let us go on towards the sixth rule. Wherein the sixth rule over here says that the day when the company declares dividend, from that day, within 5 days, the amount of dividend should be transferred to a separate account in a scheduled bank called as dividend account of the company. So the day when company declares dividend. The day when the company declares dividend, from that day, within 5 days, the amount of dividend should be transferred to a separate account in a scheduled bank called as dividend account of the company. Even this rule has been exempted to a government company. So if you are a government company, then even this rule will be acting as an exemption for you. So whether you talk about a final dividend or whether you talk about an interim dividend, the day when the dividend gets declared, from that day, maximum within 5 days, the amount of dividend should be transferred to a separate account in a scheduled bank called as dividend account of the company. Sir, can a company declare interim dividend? Yes, that's pretty obvious. If the company wants to declare. If the company wants to declare interim dividend, then yes, the company can declare an interim dividend. If in a financial year, if in between the financial year or after completing the financial year, but before calling an annual general meeting, the company wants to distribute a dividend, then such dividend is called as interim dividend. However, if in the current year the company is suffering a loss, but still the company wants to declare an interim dividend, then in that case, the rate of dividend should not be exceeding the average rate of dividend of last 3 years. The rate of dividend should not be exceeding the average rate of dividend of last 3 years. Over here, the next point says that the company can pay the dividend either in a form of cash. Dividend can be paid in a form of cash, or it can be paid in a form of warrants, or it can be paid in a form of a check, or dividend can also be paid through electronic means. Sir, the dividend has been payable to whom? The company will pay the dividend to whom? The lawmaker says the company will pay the dividend either to the registered shareholder or the dividend will be paid to his order, which means as per the direction given by the registered shareholder, or the dividend can also be paid to his banker when the dividend is going to get paid in a form of an electronic means. Over here, if your company has contravened the provisions of section number 73 and section number 74, the next rule says, if your company has contravened the provisions of section number 73 and section number 74, which is towards deposits, then sorry to say, till the time the contraventions continues, your company will be prohibited to distribute dividends. And the last point in section number 123 says that if you are a non-profit company, which means you are a section 8 company, then yes, even your company has been prohibited to distribute dividends. See, whenever we talk about section 8 companies, that is non-profit companies, then such companies are always and always working for the benefits of the society. A non-profit company has been prohibited to distribute dividends amongst its members. So yes, my dear friends, we have revised our entire provision towards section number 123 of Companies Act 2013. So yes, my dear friends, let us move on ahead towards the next topic of this chapter, that is section number 124. Section number 124 deals towards unpaid dividend account. Over here, whenever the company declares dividend, then that dividend should be distributed within 30 days. For example, if on 25th of September, the company has declared a dividend, then lawmaker says that within 30 days, that is on or before 25th of October, the dividend should get distributed. Over here, if you guys remember, whenever a company declares dividend, then the amount of dividend is been transferred to an account called as dividend account of the company. that account should have zero balance within 30 days from declaration of dividend. So, for example, on 25th September, the company had declared a dividend of 10 crores. Then by 25th October, the balance inside dividend account should be zero, should be zero. However, if some amount has been left out, then it is to be considered as dividend not paid or dividend is unclaimed. For example, on 25th of October, amount of rupees 10 lakhs is still been there inside dividend account. Why, sir? Why? There is a balance of 10 lakh rupees inside dividend account. Reason being, we had got a shareholder over here called as Mr. A. The company had sent a dividend check of rupees 6 lakhs to Mr. A. But Mr. A has still not deposited this check with his banker. So his amount is still lying with the company inside an account called as dividend account. So this is a dividend which is unclaimed. There is another shareholder over here called as Mr. B. The company had posted him a check of rupees 4 lakhs. Now over here, the postage department informed the company that Mr. B is not staying at the place which was been mentioned, which means Mr. B has changed his address, but the new address was not been communicated to the company. So these are the two amounts which are been unclaimed. The lawmaker over here says, if any amount is not paid or any amount is unclaimed, then that amount should be transferred to another account called as unpaid dividend account of the company. It should be transferred to another account called as unpaid dividend account of the company, and such transfers should have taken place within 7 days. So once more, whenever the company declares the dividend gets paid within 30 days. If any amount is been unclaimed or any amount is not been paid, then such amount will be transferred from dividend account to another account called as unpaid dividend account. Such transfers should take place within 7 days. Sir, what if within 7 days the transfers have not taken place? Law bola, it's mandatory. Anything which is unpaid or anything which is unclaimed should get transferred to a separate account called as unpaid dividend account. If such transfers are not taking place within 7 days, then yes, the company will be liable to transfer the amount with interest at the rate of 12% per annum. The company will be liable to transfer that amount with interest at the rate of 12% per annum. The day when the amount got transferred, to another account called as unpaid dividend account, then from that day within 90 days, the company will have to prepare a statement. Indicating the name of the shareholder, number of shares held, last known address, and the amount of dividend which is unclaimed. such a statement the company shall prepare within 90 days and the statement will be placed upon the website of the company. The statement will be placed upon the website of the company. Yes, it will be also been placed upon any other website which has been approved by the government. It will also been put upon any other website which has been approved by the government. Sir, the amount which was been transferred into unpaid dividend account. Yes, in our example, the amount which was been transferred was of 10 lakh rupees. Yes, we had transferred within 7 days. Hence, we did not have to transfer this amount with interest at the rate of 12% per annum. So, whatever is the amount being transferred to unpaid dividend account, that amount will be lying inside that account for how many years? The law says that amount will be lying inside the account for next 7 years. That amount will be lying inside that account for next 7 years. In this 7 years, if Mr. A or Mr. B claims their dividend amount, then the company shall refund those money to Mr. A or Mr. B, whosoever demands their dividend amount. But in this entire 7 years, if the shareholders, that is Mr. A or Mr. B, does not claim their dividend amount, Then in that case, the amount which is was been lying inside unpaid dividend account, will be transferred to a fund called as IEPF, that is Investor Education Protection Fund. So whatever is the balance inside the unpaid amount or unclaimed dividend account, that money will be transferred to a fund called as IPF if the money is not been claimed for 7 years. Okay. So, yes, my dear friends, we got to understand over here that there is a fund called as IEPF, and this fund will be discussed in depth under the provisions of section number 125. The details of this fund will be discussed under a provision called as section number 125. So, let us move on towards a portion of section number 125, that is in transfer to investment, education and protection fund. So, section number 125 deals with investors, education and protection fund. Section number 125 deals with IEPF, that is Investors Education and Protection Fund. Yes, my dear friends, this entire fund was been established by central government. The entire fund was been established by central government. The fund was been made with an object of promoting something called as awareness amongst the investors. And yes, the another object of this fund was to protect the interest of the investors. So there are two main objects of this fund, that is number one, to protect the interest of the investors, and number two, to promote awareness amongst the investors. See, this fund has been established by central government. This fund will be receiving various amounts through various modes. There are 14 different ways. There are 14 different ways through which the money will be credited inside this fund. Sir, shall we remember all these ways? The answer is no. You can remember any 5 to 6 points. Sir, which are the modes through which the money will be credited inside this fund? The lawmaker said that this fund will be receiving some kind of grants from central government. The fund will also be receiving some kind of donations from central government. we had a similar fund under Companies Act 1956, and the closing balance of that fund was been transferred into this particular fund. Every company will be having something called as an unpaid dividend account. If the dividend is not been claimed for 7 long years, then such amounts will be transferred to a fund called as IEPF. Similar way, if the company had issued debentures and the company has redeemed the debentures, but there was one particular investor who has not claimed his amount of redemption. The company was taking care of his amount for 7 long years. If in this entire 7 years, that particular investor does not claim his redemption value, then that amount will be transferred to a fund called as IEPF. The company had issued preference shares, and later on, the preference shares were being redeemed within a stipulated period of time. But there were few investors, who did not claim their redemption value. So company was taking care of that amount for 7 long years. If in this entire 7 years, if they claim their money, the company shall refund it. But if they have not claimed their money, then that money will be transferred towards a fund called as IEPF. The company had raised the funds by accepting deposits. Later on, the company had given some maturity to the depositors. But there were few depositors, who did not claim their maturity amount. So company was taking care of that maturity amount for 7 long years. If in this entire 7 years, if the depositors claims their money, the company shall refund the money. But if the depositors do not claim their money, then in that case, the money that has been unclaimed for 7 long years will be transferred towards a fund called as IEPF. Over here, the company had gone for a fresh issue. Few people subscribed. To those issue, and yes, the issue was oversubscribed. So, however, allotment cannot be done to every person. So, over here, the company refunded the application money. But there were two or three investors. Who did not took their application money from the company. So, company was taking care of that money for 7 long years. And after that 7 long years, the application money which was being refunded but not been taken by the investor, then such money will be transferred to a fund called as IEPF, that is Investors Education and Protection Fund. Over here, the company had gone for some kind of a bonus issue. Over here, there was a shareholder holding 35 shares in that company. The company made a declaration that they are going to issue bonus shares. That is, for every 2 shares held, 1 bonus share will be given. So shareholder holding 35 shares will be getting 17.5 shares as bonus. However, shares cannot be given in decimal. So that particular investor was been given 17 bonus shares. And for that 0.5, he was given some kind of an amount. So that is called as a fractional share, for which the company paid him some amount. The investor did not claim that amount, and for 7 long years, the amount was been lying with the company, which was unclaimed. So even that money will get transferred. Towards a fund called as IEPF. So yes, my dear friends, through various ways, IEPF gets credited. So there are 14 different ways through which the funds will flow. There will be inflow of funds inside IEPF. If there is inflow, So yes, there would also be something called as outflow. The fund money can be utilized. The fund money can be utilized for following five purposes. The fund money can be utilized for following five purposes. If any person is claiming his money back, so that person can go to the IEPF and claim his money back. For example, in our case, Mr. B, after 10 years, comes to know that his money was been lying inside IPF, then Mr. B can directly approach and get the refund of his money. The fund money can also be utilized for promoting something called as education among the investors, promoting awareness amongst the investor, and yes, to protect the investor. Yes, the money which is lying inside the fund can also be utilized for distribution of a discharged amount, The money lying inside the fund can also be utilized for reimbursement of legal expenses. For example, a company issued a prospectus which was a misstated one. Over here, the investors who are acting as an aggrieved party wanted to file a case against the company, but they were having no funds to file a case against the company. So yes, those aggrieved party can take the help of the fund. The fund will reimburse them something called as legal expenses. And yes, the money lying inside the fund can also be utilized for any other purpose. Okay, so IEPF gets various credits and there are few debits. Through credits, the money will coming inside the fund, and through debits, the money will be going outside the fund. So this entire fund has been established by central government. Okay, so do you guys feel that Mr. Modi ji will be taking care of this entire fund? No, that's not possible. So over here, in order to administer this fund, in order to have proper maintenance of accounts, the fund will be completely managed by few people called as an authority, Those few people will be appointed by central government. So law says, in order to administer this fund, in order to maintain the accounts of this fund, few group of people will be appointed, and those people are being considered as an authority. First of all, there will be a chairperson. The entire authority will be headed by a person called as a chairperson, and who will be acting as a chairperson? The law says the secretary of the MCA. The secretary of the MCA shall be the ex officio chairperson of the authority. So whosoever is acting as the secretary of the MCA shall be the person to be considered as the chairperson of this entire authority. There can be maximum 7 members, but right now there are 6 members. And there will be a CEO who shall be acting as a convener. If this entire authority, requires any kind of resources, for example, they require an office, they require some officers, in short, this entire authority requires any kind of resources, they can directly approach the central government, and central government will help the authority with the resources. Yes, the entire authority is been asked to maintain proper accounts, because there are various credits and there are various debits. So there has to be proper maintenance of accounts, for which the authority can consult C&AG. Yes, the authority will be competent enough to decide where the money should be utilized and how much the money should be utilized. Yes, The entire fund will be subject to audit, and the audit work will be carried on by CNAG. The audit work will be carried on by CNAG. Once the audit work is been done, CNAG will prepare an audit report, and such audit report will be forwarded to the central government. Such audit report will be forwarded to the central government. Law says the authority will have to prepare something called as an annual report. Year after year, year after year, the authority will have to prepare something called as an annual report. And yes, even that annual report will be forwarded to central government. So central government is going to receive two reports. One is an audit report, another is an annual report. Both of these reports, central government will have to lay down before each house of the parliament, that is the upper house as well as the lower house. Upper house means Rajya Sabha and lower house stands for Lok Sabha. So yes, my dear friends, we have successfully completed the revision for section number 124 along with section number 125 of Companies Act 2013. So let us begin the last part of this chapter, that is section number 127. Section number 127 of Companies Act 2013 deals with punishment for failure to distribute dividends. Punishment for failure to distribute dividends. Yes, my dear friends, first of all, declaration of dividend is completely optional. Declaration of dividend is completely optional. But once the dividend has been declared, then yes, it is mandatory upon a company to make the payment of that dividend. It is mandatory upon a company to make the payment of that dividend. Law says that the day when the dividend gets declared, from that day within 30 days, the company shall make the payment of dividend. The company shall make the payment of dividend, or else the company should at least post the dividend warrants. The company should at least post the dividend warrants. Over here, if the company has posted the dividend warrant within 30 days, but the dividend warrant does not get received by the shareholder, then in that case, the company should not be held responsible. Sir, what if dividend has been declared, but it is not been paid within 30 days? Sir, what if dividend has been declared, but it does not get paid within 30 days? In that case, law says the company has failed in fulfilling the provision for which there will be a punishment for such failure. Over here, if the company fails to pay declared dividends, or else the company fails to post the dividend warrants within 30 days of its declaration, then the following punishments will be made applicable. Wherein the lawmaker said that every director of the company will be asked to go for an imprisonment up to 2 years. That is, those directors who were knowingly a party to the default. You are a director, you know the company has done a default, still too, you are keeping silence, then yes, you are a person who is liable under section number 127. Along with it, the director will also be asked to pay a fine, which will be of 1,000 rupees for every day during which such default continues. 1,000 rupees for every day during which such default continues. Yes, even the company will be liable to the shareholders. The company will be asked to pay a simple interest at the rate of 18% per annum for the period of delay. So, for example, if the dividend was been declared on 25th of September, it should have been paid within 30 days, which means the dividend should have been paid by 25th of October. However, if the payments were being made on 25th of December, then for this entire 2 months, the company will be liable to pay interest at the rate of 18% per annum. The company will be liable to pay interest at the rate of 18% per annum. Sir, are there any exemptions from the above provisions? Law says yes, there is an exemption from the above provision, that is from the above punishment. If any of the following statements gets proved, if any of the circumstances gets arised, then yes, no offense will be assumed to have been committed, and therefore there won't be any punishment getting attracted. If any of the following provisions, if any of the following circumstances rather gets proved, then in that case there is no offense being deemed, and hence there is no punishment getting attracted. The very first provision over here says that if the company has declared the dividend but the company could not pay it within 30 days because of the operation of any law, that is because of provision of any law. Because of the provision of law, the company could not pay that dividend amount, then law says it's not the fault of the company. The company has not committed any default. Hence, no offense is deemed to be committed by the company, which means no punishment will be attracted either upon the company nor upon the directors of the company. The second circumstance over here says that a shareholder of the company had given a direction to the company regarding the payment of the dividend. Shareholder said to the company that my dividend should be given to this following institute, and this is the way by which it should be paid. The company was trying to comply with the divisions, but however, the company failed to comply with those directions. The company failed to comply with that directions given. Over here, the company has communicated the same thing to its shareholder, but shareholder never gave a new direction to the company. So even in that case, if the dividend which has been declared does not get paid within 30 days, it is neither the fault committed by the company nor its directors. Hence, no punishments will be attracted upon them. So once again, the very first situation says dividend could not get paid because of the provision of law. Okay, exemption from the punishment. Shareholder gave a direction to the company. Company was trying to fulfill those directions, but however, the company was not in a position to comply those directions, and the company has communicated the same thing to the shareholder. The third one over here says that there is a dispute regarding the right to receive the dividend. Who is the real person who should receive the dividend? There is a dispute for the same. So unless and until the dispute does not get resolved, till that time the company is not in a position to pay dividend to those particular shareholders. So whenever there is a dispute regarding the right to receive the dividend, even in that case there is something called as an exemption from the punishment. Okay, law says the amount of dividend was being lawfully adjusted by the company against any money due to it from the shareholder. If the shareholder was having any kind of liability to the company, but the shareholder was not paying that liability, and meantime if the company declares a dividend, then the amount of dividend can be lawfully adjusted against the liability of that particular shareholder. See, a simple example I like to give over here, wherein there is a shareholder Mr. X who is having some liability with the company. Mr. X is liable to the company for ₹1,000. Meantime, the company has declared a dividend and Mr. X has got a right to receive a dividend of ₹1,000. So instead of making the payment of ₹1,000 to Mr. X, the company will adjust that ₹1,000 against the liability of Mr. X. The last point says dividend could not be paid due to any other reason. And one of the reason they have given over here, which we have already completed, which says that the company has given the dividend warrants. The company has posted the dividend warrants. But such dividend warrants did not reach to the shareholder wherein there was no default from the part of the company. Might be there might be some problem with the postage department. There is no kind of default made by the company. So in this following five circumstances, even if the dividend is declared but not been paid, then there is an exemption from the punishment. So yes, my dear friends, we have successfully completed our entire revision of a chapter called as chapter number 8, that is declaration and payment of dividend, wherein we have covered the provisions from section number 123 up to section number 127. So that's all towards our revisionary part of chapter number 8, that was declaration and payment of dividend. Thank you so much.